Until yesterday, not yesterday, until last week, we were looking at different types of tissues in plant as such, including meristematic tissue and the permanent tissue. And then we had looked at different subtypes of them, including xylem, phloem, and so on. Yeah, I'll not go back and revise that part again. And like I had mentioned that I am going to simplify these slides from xylem and phloem tissue, which I still haven't done, but I'll do it maybe by this week for sure, so that you will have a concrete thing for at least these tissues in terms of your exam. So you don't have to go through whole of this description and so on. So those were the main types. Now, apart from that, there are certain specialized structures within the plant which are still forming the certain layers, or which are still part of the earlier described types. But then we have to look at these specific types based on what function they are doing. So, for example, there is a separate tissue, not separate as in these are ultimately type of your meristematic tissue, that is epidermis, when it is growing. So epidermis is one type of protective tissue where the cells are making an outer covering of the structure. So for example, if it is a leaf, the outermost layer is epidermis. If it is a stem, it will be outermost layer will be the epidermis, and so on. And root, of course, will also have it. And why are we talking this as a specialized structure in terms of protection? Because it has a small cellular structure which is called as stomata. Actually, we are going to study about this whole structural arrangement of the leaf in another chapter called transpiration, where we are going to study the function and structure of stomata and so on. But here, just to brief you about it. So epidermis is actually different layer of a single layer of cells, that is epidermal cells they are called. And within these epidermal cells, there is a stomata structure. Now stomata is something like, let's say if you have two kidney beans, right? Everyone knows that what kidney beans is. And if you put them face to face, then at the center of these two kidney beans, there will be a small opening which is left because of the curvature of the shape, and that particular opening is nothing but like stomata, and those two cells, they are called as guard cells. And these whole arrangement of guard cells with stomata is present within the epidermal layer. So that is what allows the loss of water and gaseous exchange. Now when the roots are absorbing a lot of water, it goes towards the leaf. And from leaf, if it is in excess, it will go out through the leaf structure in the vapor form. And also when the carbon dioxide is taken by the leaf structure, it is exchanged through this stomatal structure through the epidermal layer. So that is the main function of the epidermis. Apart from protection, it also serves as exchange medium for the water as well as gases. So that is epidermis. So just to show you quickly, we had already seen this particular diagram. So this, you see this light green or pista color border that you see around the section of the leaf, that is nothing but the epidermis. And there is upper epidermis and lower epidermis. So for example, if my hand or my palm is the leaf, the surface which is facing the sunlight will have upper epidermis, and the surface which is not facing the sunlight will be lower epidermis. And lower epidermis has maximum number of stomata, and upper epidermis has almost no or very few number of stomata. So that is the distinguishing feature of the upper and lower epidermis. And but in general, in terms of composition of the epidermal cell, it is same, just the number of stomata are more on the lower side and less on the upper side. And if you look at the stem or the section of the stem also, you can see this outermost layer, which is shown here in green color, that is nothing but the epidermis. And even in case of root, if you see, the epidermis is the outermost, this light brown layer that is being shown, that is the epidermis for the root. So in all these plant structures, epidermis is always present there, which is the outermost covering, and there are stomatas in case of leaf. There are different structure in stem, and root doesn't have any such opening like stomata, but we will see that. We need not go into that detail as of now. What you need to know is epidermis, which is the outermost layer of leaf, stem, root, and it performs the function of protection of the internal structure. And when in leaf, it performs the function of water and gas exchange. So that is the epidermis layer. Then second one is the cork. Now this is the external protective tissue, especially on the stem and the root structure, but which are matured, that means which are grown old, on that only these cork structures are present. These are nothing but the dead cells, like the when the epidermal cells, they die over the time, they form that hard layer. Like you have seen a bark, right? Bark is nothing but like the inner layer of the bark. You have these different small layer like structures, especially on the older trees, that is nothing but the cork. Again, this particular structure we are going to see later in some chapter, so we need not go much in detail. Otherwise, the cork cells, they are lifeless and they lack intercellular gaps. They are, that means they don't have any intercellular gap. They are very compact and lifeless, because obviously they are dead. How they will have life? And their walls are coagulated by suberin. Now this is again one of the important part. Like for example, in sclerenchyma, you had thicker walls of lignin. In sclerenchyma, the cell wall of those particular sclerenchymal cells, they were covered with lignin. In this case, it is suberin and nothing different. And this suberin is nothing like but a biomolecule which is of like what you can say, a plant cell wall component, which is more giving the texture of the cell to become hard. Cell has to become little harder, and that is what the cork cell is. Again, you can relate it to the how a bark is, and these are something similar to them. And because of this presence of the suberin, it will make these cork cells or cork structure like for exchange of gas and water molecule, it will allow to exchange it. So again, you imagine the bark is never like completely covering the stem. There are always certain gaps in between, and below those bark structure you will find these cork cells, and they will have this exchangeability of the gas and molecule. So that is the cork and epidermis. Does anyone have any question here? This might get little kind of boring, I must say, but yeah, please bear with me. We need to be aware of these few things. So after this protective tissue, there is just the last one from the plant tissue, that is the glandular tissue, or also called as secondary tissue, or it is also called as secretory tissue. If it is a glandular tissue, it is obviously going to secrete something, for example, like gums, resins, volatile oils, nectar and latex and so on. So there are so many compounds which plants secrete. They chemically, they are very different. Composition wise, they are different. But again, that is not the part of our discussion. What we need to know, gums, everyone knows that sticky substance which is being secreted. Volatile oils, everyone knows. Nectar, everyone knows. Latex is something that milky fluid that comes out when you chop off the stem or the leaf. That is the latex part. Resins are chemical compounds, so I need not discuss about this here. So again, in glandular, the two types that we want to look for is the laticiferous tissue. Because they secrete this latex, they are called as laticiferous, and they are thick-walled, greatly elongated. That is just the physical description of it. and there are numerous nuclei present in these layers of the tissue, and because of that they always keep synthesizing this latex as a fluid, and that's why they are called as laticiferous tissue. The another type of glandular tissue itself, which secretes the oil, gum, resins and tannins. Again, there are special names to these in terms of structure, but we are not going to go into that detail. We will just call them as glandular tissue, which can give out either the secretory product or excretory product. I hope you are aware of the difference between secretion and excretion. Secretion is usually the internal process, that is, let's say thyroid gland secreting thyroid hormone, pancreas secreting insulin, or the oral cavity secreting saliva. These are secretion. Excretion is usually urine is excreted and so on, right? So one a general outline of this would be something that is secreted internally, that is secretion, something that is excreted or secreted outside of the body, and which is a waste product or byproduct, which is not required, that is excretion. So that is what is the general difference. And they may have a bunch of cells forming a central cavity. You can imagine all the cells, they are forming a group of cells in a round shape, and at the center they will have this glandular tissue which will secrete different compounds like oil, gums, resins, tannins, and in case of external there will be these water secreting hairs or glands, for example. So that these are the two topics that we had to cover in this plant tissue as such. Does anyone have any question? Otherwise, we will shift to the animal tissue. And I hope you all are with me.
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Okay. So that was all about the plant tissue. Now, jumping over to the animal tissues, we already know the basics of these animal tissues and so on. What are their functions? What are they specialized for? And so on, right? The basic aspect of it, we already know why they are present, how they are present, and so on. Just a little more depth to what we already know. So I'm not going to discuss about the rest of the topics. Rest of the statements related to animal tissue. I'll directly jump into the types of animal tissue. That is, these are four different types called epithelial, connective, muscular, and nervous tissue. These are the four different types of the animal tissues present in the most of the animal. Now, I hope that is fine that I have skipped some of the content and you know the basics. Yeah, if you don't, you let me know and then we will discuss it as well. So in case of epithelial tissue, which is the first type of the animal tissue, this is usually forming the covering of the external surfaces. That is, let's say, for example, brain is there. Brain has the outermost layer, right? That is the external covering. I'm not talking about the skull. Just within that whole brain structure, the outermost layer next to the, on the outermost wall of the brain, that's what will be epithelial tissue. The internal cavities, so for example, your stomach, intestine, they all have the internal cavities. That is the lumen of those organs, that is the hollow portion which is present inside these organs, that is the internal cavities, and of course many other organs, they have this epithelial tissue. The main characteristic of this epithelial tissue is they are tightly packed and they form a continuous sheet. Now imagine intestinal wall. If it is not tightly packed, the food particles that can easily escape through the intestine itself, or let's say for example stomach. If the stomach innermost wall is not tightly packed and not as a continuous sheet, then the food or even acid can leak out from the stomach itself. So not to let that happen. And not only these gastrointestinal system, even in case of lung, we have these cavities so that the gases, they are not leaked anywhere else, but through alveoli they are carried into the blood. So there are many such structures which need the arrangement of epithelial tissue in a very tightly packed cells and forming a continuous layer. So that's why their arrangement is like that. Now another example is the skin, the lining of the mouth or the lining of the blood vessel, lung alveoli and kidney tubules. All of these, they are made up of epithelial tissue. Skin, you already know, there are various layers in the skin, that is dermis, epidermis, serosa, mucosa and so on, right? Muscularis, blah blah, there are like quite a few layers. Now this skin, like at least the uppermost layer or the outermost layer, these are the epithelial tissues. And the lining of the mouth, that is the oral cavity that you have inside your mouth around the teeth and tongue structure, that is also epithelial tissue. The lining of the blood vessel, that is the innermost part of the blood vessel, these are specifically called as endothelium, right? Epi refers to outside, endo refers to inside. And only in case of blood vessels, the epithelial tissue, they are called as endothelial cells or endothelial tissues, or in singularity it is called as endothelium. Yeah, so that is with the case with the blood vessel, which is nothing but the epithelial tissue. And lung alveoli, like I had explained, and the kidney tubules, that is the nephron structure that you are aware of, that also has this epithelial tissue. Imagine again a kidney which has to filter the blood and allow the urine to get separate from the blood after various absorption and reabsorption process. So that function is done by the epithelial tissue of the kidneys, ultimately of the nephron. So these are the different structural and functional aspects. Now specifically looking at the function of the epithelial tissues, like we already briefed, epithelium covers most organ and cavities within the body. So ultimately protection is one of the function. It also forms a barrier to keep different body systems separate. Like you are already aware that we have thoracic cavity, we have diaphragm, we have abdominal cavity, or we have this upper like head cavity, head as in the brain cavity and so on. So all these cavities, they are separate, and the reason being because there is a layer of epithelial tissue which is being present at these different borders. The permeability, third point, the permeability of the cells of various epithelia play an important role in the exchange of materials between body and the external environment. Now again, I'll go back to the example of the gastrointestinal tract. There, when you eat food, it gets chopped off or broken down into smaller particles, and then when it goes in from intestine to stomach, stomach to intestine, it again is broken down further by the peristaltic movement, and it is mixed with different juices, different acids and secretions, and then it is broken to the finest, very little tiny molecules, and these molecules, they are getting absorbed from the epithelial tissue into the blood. Intestine is again a rich in terms of blood capillary network. So from the intestinal layer, these small molecules, which are so-called nutrition for us, they are getting absorbed into the blood through the capillary network. Other example is, for example, you are taking a paracetamol tablet, right? It will go into the stomach. It will dissolve slowly and it will get absorbed from some part from stomach, some from intestine, and that exchange or that allowing the paracetamol molecule to permeate or to pass through the epithelium. That is one of the important functions. So all the different medicines that you know, when we take it orally, they allow the transport of this molecule. Now, another beautiful fact.
So what is the rejected?
What is the
medicine? What if the tissue rejects the medicine or it is not allowed to pass through?
Then it does not. But usually when we do these testing of the medicine, we usually study their absorption patterns. So if it is not getting absorbed, we either change the drug, like making, let's say, paracetamol into some form like acetate, lactate or whatever. Or we break it, we make synthesize newly designed compound which looks like paracetamol and they have similar actions like paracetamol. So if it is not getting absorbed, then it is of no use and it won't be approved as a drug. So when we get the approval for individual medicine or individual drug molecule, we have to show all this data to those authorities so that they can approve. So usually all the drugs that you know of or that you are aware of or taking it, any human being, they usually have certain absorption.
Okay.
But there are few drugs like that's actually going into the deeper aspects of absorption itself. Like for example, there is something called as P-glycoprotein, which is present on the inner surface of the epithelium in intestine. Let's say some protein name, forget about P-glycoprotein. You need not remember the name. If you remember, well and good. But it's a P-glycoprotein or some protein which is present on the inner wall of the intestine. And that allows reflux of some molecule, which is called as drug resistance, which is not the natural course of action. But in some of the cases, when there is lot of expression of this protein, instead of drug getting absorption, after absorption, drug is thrown back into the intestinal cavity. And then from intestine, it goes through the excreta or the stool, right, through the anus. So that way, with some of the drug, that does happen. Like they are getting absorbed, but they are again thrown back into the intestinal cavity. So that does happen as well. But that is not because of the epithelium as such. It's just because of the certain proteins which are present on this epithelial walls.
Sir, how do you remember so many names, sir?
How many?
How do you remember so many names of different things? I get really confused of how you do that.
Well, I just have been studying about it. So, I mean, there is...
what do you do to remember it?
What? So what I did when I was studying is, like, this is the knowledge that I am carrying from my bachelor degree, which is probably what, 15 years back or so.
Okay.
I used to write notes quite a lot. And if you would have seen my books, I don't know if they exist anymore at my home, but my books were less of the text and more of my writing. So that's how it used to be. So I used to make quite a lot of notes. I used to revise quite often. There would be hardly any book which I have not revised at least 4 or 5 times. So that's how I had studied earlier.
But what about when you were 9, 10, 10? Like, you weren't specialized, like you had to do other stuff also?
9th and 10, I was even more smarter. So I knew that this particular teacher will give so-and-so worksheet or so-and-so. So I used to prepare all in advance. When I used to go to classes, I used to read that beforehand.
Okay.
So let's say I'm going to teach today about epithelial tissue. I will read it beforehand before coming to the class.
Sir, I went through the slide before coming to class.
But then these topics that we are discussing, they are out of the scope. So that way you may not find that content. But yeah, so, okay. One of the interesting facts I again must tell you is, let's say whenever there is heart patients, so like those people who get stroke because of the high blood pressure, the immediate remedy is to give a nitric oxide tablet and keep it below the tongue. Now, why specifically below the tongue? Because that particular area has lot of blood capillaries. Oral mucosa, like, don't try this, but like if at all there is a cut in the oral mucosa below the tongue, the blood flows like a pipeline. So that is how profuse blood supply is there, like quite a lot of it. It's like, you know, you cutting, not you cutting, but someone cuts this vein on the wrist. It's something like that. It's quite a lot of blood capillaries even in the oral mucosa. So when we keep the nitric oxide tablet in those heart patients, let's say someone gets a heart attack, so the usually their relatives, they are being trained for this. They immediately keep a nitric oxide tablet below the tongue, so it gets absorbed faster. So the blood pressure is reduced within 5 minutes. Like that fast is the action. Like usually, normally drugs take some 15 to 20 minutes, but within less than 5 minutes, like let's say between 1 minute to 5 minutes, the nitric oxide tablet will show its effect because it's getting absorbed through the oral mucosa, gets dissolved, like gets into the blood, and then from there it goes and act onto different organs or blood vessels. So that way, this permeability of these cells of epithelium plays a very, very, very important role in regulating exchange of material, whether it is a drug molecule or whether it is a nutritious molecule. In all of these cases, it really does a wonder. Then the next function, which is another specialized function of epithelial tissue, is having this external structure. So on the surface of the epithelial tissue, in some of the cases, not all the epithelial tissue, but some of the epithelial tissue, they have this flagella or cilia-like structure, which are nothing but a hair-like projection. Cilia is actually a hair-like projection. Flagella is just little longer projection. I'm sure you had studied this prokaryotic cell and bacteria with flagella or without flagella. So that is just flagella is nothing but a whip or a hair-like structure outside the body of a cell. So that is flagella and cilia. Microvilli, these are very, very, very like a zigzag structure. So let's say we have intestinal wall from the inside. It is not plain. It is like, you all know speed breakers, which comes like when the vehicle goes from it, there are multiple speed breakers within a stretch. But if you extend those speed breakers quite to a height, let's say a half a meter or so, that will form a villi-like structure or microvilli-like structure. So in the intestinal lining, what you have is those troughs, wave-like structure. And okay, that is what gives more absorption area to the intestinal content or whatever is coming from stomach to intestine. That will give more surface area for the absorption. So that is the main function of microvilli. And cilia, like we all know, we have nose. Of course, we have nose. But inside nose, there is the epithelium layer. And that epithelium layer has this hair-like growth inside the nose. That is nothing but cilia. So, these are the different examples in terms of functional aspect of epithelial tissue. Okay, any question here? Anyone wants to ask any question? Prakriti?
Yeah, sir.
Any question?
No.
Okay. I randomly took your name, by the way, so don't worry. So, so these are the basic structural arrangement and the function of the epithelial tissue. Now we will look at what are those different types of epithelial tissues which are present in the animals. So first let me show you the diagram, so which will make it more clear what these tissues are. Like we know, epithelial tissues, they are tightly packed, they are present on the external cavity or the inner lining of the organs. So they can be of any of these types. This one is the simple squamous epithelium, and when the same, this is a single layer of cell, right? Squamous is like these cells, they are not like really fixed in shape, they are irregularly shaped in a way, and they, when they are arranged in different layers, that is called as stratified squamous. So simple squamous and stratified squamous. Stratified means layers or arranged in layers. That's what is the meaning of stratified. So we also have stratified fibers, stratified layers, and so on. So this is the simple squamous and stratified squamous. Then there is a cuboidal, that is simple cuboidal epithelial tissue, and stratified cuboidal epithelial tissue. Again, the shapes of the cell is cuboidal, so they are called as simple cuboid. And when they are arranged in different layers, that is called as stratified cuboid. So same cuboidal cells in different layers, maybe 2 or 3 or 4, or depending on whatever is the organ, these are stratified cuboid. Then third type is the columnar epithelium, that is simple columnar epithelium. And here it is pseudo-stratified columnar. Pseudo-stratified means it is not actually in layers, but it looks like it is layer. Yeah, just the structural arrangement. That's why it is called as pseudo-stratified, like false layer of the columnar epithelium. So that is the simple and columnar. And transitional is kind of mix of these, but we are not going to look into this transitional type as such. So we'll just look at few of these types of the epithelial tissue. I hope structure wise everyone has the clarity how these layers are, not to get frightened by these words stratified or simple or squamous and cuboidal. Nothing like is that difficult here. It just squamous means a simple irregular shaped cells. They are arranged in layers that become stratified squamous, and then cuboidal and stratified cuboidal, and so on.
So from pseudo stratified, I remember pseudopodia. The
pseudopodia is a again a different structure, but
yeah, it's
a but say.
Yeah, so like pseudopodia, it's very irregular in the sense. It does not have a cell wall. And
pseudopodia is that amoeba's structure when it extends the arms. That is what is pseudopodia.
They have this so many flagella kind of things, like they use them to attach to this thing and that.
Yeah, actually pods is something like a limb. Or like we have hands and legs, that it, these are limbs. So pods refers to limbs. So that pseudo limb like structure, or that's what it is called as pseudopodia.
Yeah.
Okay, so we will just look at the brief description of these epithelial tissue, and then we will stop. We will not go to the next type. So that we'll do in next class. So the first type of the epithelial tissue, that is simple squamous epithelium. Structurally, you already know these are irregular shaped and so on, arranged in a single layer when we talk of simple squamous epithelium. Where these are present in the inner lining of the blood vessels and the lung alveoli. So you know already blood vessels, you also know lung alveoli. Their innermost lining will have this simple squamous epithelium. And again, the function will be, you can imagine what does it do in the blood vessel and what does it do in the lung alveoli. That will allow a selectively permeable surface so that there is exchange of certain substances, that is transportation of substances across these walls. They are relatively simple, flat, extremely thin compared to all the other types. Like again, if I go back diagram and you can look at a single layer of these cells is very thin compared to cuboidal as well as columnar. So to have that permeability, this thinner layer is very much helpful. And it is also found in the inner lining of the mouth, esophagus, lung, and lung alveoli. Okay, that is already done here. So the oral cavity, that is the mouth, and the esophagus, that is the food pipe, that will have this simple squamous epithelium. Then stratified squamous epithelium, which is nothing but the different layers of the simple squamous epithelium, but present at different locations. For example, skin, which is one of the major defense mechanism of the whole body, that is the skin, which is present in different layers, like I had already said, and they are arranged in many layers to prevent the wear and tear. So like if there is a external injury on the skin, so to have more and more protection, that's why skin layer is much thicker than like the internal epithelial layers, and that is what is your stratified squamous epithelium. Now, I don't think there is anything else more to explain here. The third type is the cuboidal epithelium, that is the shapes are cuboidal of these cells, and they are present in the kidney tubules, right? So kidney tubules, that refers to your nephron structure ultimately, and the ducts of the salivary glands. Now, how exactly? These cuboidal cells, they are specialized for some of the glandular epithelium type. Glandular epithelium means they have presence of glands within those cuboidal layers. So for example, I will go back to diagram. So let's say this cuboidal, or I can show you here also. Yeah, these are the when the cuboidal cells, they are arranged in a circle like manner, they form the innermost cavity, right? So that is what is nothing but they are ideally the cuboidal or simple cuboidal cells, but just arranged in a circle manner. And if they are performing a function of secretion like a gland, then they are called as the glandular epithelium, or they are also called as glandular cuboidal epithelium. So they are ultimately same, just they are performing a function of secretion. And sometimes even the absorption in some of the cases, whatever they are secreting. So that is the cuboidal epithelium and glandular epithelium. And the last and the fourth type in the epithelial tissue that we are seeing is the columnar epithelium, where the absorption and secretion occurs in the inner lining of the intestine. So this intestinal lining has this columnar epithelial cells, which are relatively tall, like you know it from the structure, and that's why they are named as columnar. They are also present in the respiratory tract, and they have certain cilia structures on their wall. So within the respiratory tract, that is through trachea and so on, even in the bronchi and bronchioles, they have this columnar epithelium, but this columnar epithelium has this cilia, or which is a hair-like structure. So the function of the cilia is to move or push the mucus forward to clear it. Cilia is a movement-related structure. Now, it does not really allow the movement of the columnar epithelium cell, but it allows the movement of mucus to move up and down through the trachea or the respiratory tract. And that is why that is what is the function of the ciliated columnar epithelium. So, four types: simple squamous, which is present in the blood vessel and the lung alveoli and also in the mouth. Then the stratified squamous epithelium, present in the skin. Cuboidal epithelium, which is also a glandular epithelium, is present in the kidney tubules and the ducts of salivary glands. See, mouth also has simple squamous epithelium, and it also has cuboidal epithelium. But when it is cuboidal epithelium, it performs the function of salivation very specifically. Yeah, so do not get confused there. Cuboidal epithelium is related to secretion, and the simple epithelium, simple squamous epithelium, is more as a allowing the permeability or allowing certain molecules to get transported. And the last type is the columnar epithelium, which is present along the respiratory tract and in the intestine. And it has this cilia-like structure. And in case of intestine, it has microvilli-like structure, which we had already seen those wave-like structure. And just to mention this, now these were the based on the structure. Based on function also, you can classify epithelial tissue. For example, sensory epithelium. Those epithelial tissue which are going to perceive a stimuli, they will be sensory epithelium. For example, nose or skin, they are all epithelial tissues and they perceive a stimuli. So, they are sensory epithelium. Glandular epithelium, they will secrete chemicals. For example, stomach lining, right? Innermost lining of the stomach has certain cells which secretes acid, right? Or intestinal inner lining secretes intestinal juices. So they are glandular epithelium, or the oral cavity has salivary glands. That is nothing but the glandular epithelium, part of epithelial tissue, but specifically of glandular type. Pigmented epithelium imparts color in retina. Now, this is something you have a color of your eye, right? That is because of the epithelial layer which is present in the eye structure that is pigmented with certain color molecule. That's why you get a color to the eye. Even in case of skin also, the complexion of our skin is depending on the what how much is the melanin pigment, and that is also epithelium.
So the amount of melanin in your skin can change also, right? Time to time.
The melanin content of the skin
can change also, right? Like,
yeah, of course it does. That's why we have all these beauty products which blocks the melanin secretion. Like those fairness creams that you see in cosmetics, or they all do, or there is this white glow and so on. All of those products, they ultimately kind of either block the melanin synthesis or they interfere with that process so that they don't allow more of the melanin to get it,
right? So like, but how can they block it? Like, you just apply it on your skin.
So through the skin layers, so this melanin gets synthesized in the deeper layers of the skin, right? So through the localized application of these creams or so, these creams go into the deeper layers of the skin, and there they have chemical, let's say, incompatibility, for example, and they will block the pathways.
But that won't be permanent, right?
That won't be permanent. But like, if it is on continuous application, then it tend to become permanent, because those cells, they become adapted to that situation. So they stop melanin secretion after a while. So it depends what is the duration of vision and so on.
If they stop secreting melanin, so you'll become like chalk white or what?
No, come again.
So if melanin is stopped, like if there is no melanin, then will you become chalk white?
No. There will always be some basal amount of melanin which is being secreted. Also, this is genetically defined. This is not only externally. You can't change your color of the skin drastically until and unless you do bleaching of the skin, which some of the actor and actresses, they do it. It is called as bleaching process, which is totally a different process. But there also you play around with the melanin pigmentation, so that your skin becomes more whitish.
So, yes, if we don't have melanin, so we could get skin cancer, right? Because of the UV rays?
Depends on what is the situation. Not always that those who do not have melanin, they are, the chances of having cancer in those cases is higher for sure. But that does not mean that you will always have a cancer. So there is a difference in these two things. Yeah. But chances are surely high. Okay. And the last part, which we had already seen, based on the function, the type of epithelial tissue, that is the absorptive epithelium, which is used for the absorption purpose. again the intestine and so or the stomach, these are the absorptive epithelium. So these are the function based epithelial tissue. So these four were structure based and these were the function based. They ultimately overlap with each other, but that is the different types. And this diagram I have kept it here just to show you how the ciliated epithelium look like. So these are the columnar epithelial cells which have the cilia like structure, like I said, in case of respiratory tract, to allow the movement of the mucus. These are ciliated structure which are present in the trachea like structure. Okay, so connective tissue will start in the next class. We will stop here. If anyone has any question, you can ask.